I've been
Amen. Thank you, Carolyn and Clay, for bringing us our prelude music this morning. Obviously, they pre-recorded that for us so that we can have that beautiful music about our theme today. As we continue our series on the Ten Commandments, today we're talking about the Sabbath, having a Sabbath, having a time of rest and holy time. We're talking about that today. But we'll begin, as always, with a few announcements this morning. First of all, we are going to open for worship again beginning Sunday, March 7th at the normal 10 o'clock time. We will be using every other pew as we did previously and wearing masks. So please, even if you've received both doses of the vaccine by then, even if you've already had the virus, still please ask that we space ourselves in the sanctuary and wear masks. We also have a door that we will open to ventilate the room as well, letting some cool air will make the air ventilate in here as well. So we'll have the normal ventilation system moving in the room. Of course, you can still watch from home. There's certainly no pressure or anything for anybody to come. Simply, if you'd like to be able to come back and be here in person, the numbers continue to look better, continuing going down. I'm watching very carefully, so hopefully that will continue to happen as more and more people receive the vaccine. But we'll open up in March, and we'll spread out in the pews and wear masks. Also, on that day, on Sunday, March 7th, there'll be a drive-through spaghetti dinner to help raise money for the Sleep in Heavenly Peace mission effort. I think the guys might have a slide to pull up there. There you go. Since we can't send a team to ASP this year, on 2 days in June, the 18th and 19th, we'll be working with a new local mission to build beds for people in need right here in the communities around us. You can contact the church to order spaghetti meals in advance, but we will be making extra. They'll start serving the people who are here in worship at 11 right after worship, so they can take their spaghetti with them when worship is over. And they'll begin serving everyone else at 11:30, kind of like a drive-through at a fast food restaurant. So when you're done watching worship from home, you can come over here and drive through the parking lot, back around the kitchen door there, and they'll bring spaghetti to you. And they'll be serving spaghetti until 3. Again, this is to help raise the $6,000 we need for the summer mission project. There'll be youth but adults involved as well. You can also simply designate an offering to that mission if you'd like. And we need people to help with the spaghetti dinner in different ways. So if you're willing to do that, you don't have to necessarily be in the kitchen where there will be some people cooking. You can be spread out and doing other things to help. So if you'd like to help, please let us know. Thanks, guys. Next Sunday, I will not be here. I have the honor of performing Ben Penman's wedding to his beautiful fiance, which sadly for me is taking place in Orlando, Florida. It's very sad that that's where it's taking place. So Janelle and I will be flying down with John and Tammy Penman on Wednesday, coming back on Monday. His wedding is on Saturday. So Jack Norton will be preaching next Sunday to enable me to be there to perform the wedding. So thanks, Jack, for covering for me. But we'll still have worship, of course, next week, just that Jack will be preaching. There will not be an Ash Wednesday service this week, as I can't physically place ashes on people's foreheads, which kind of defeats the purpose of the service. So we won't be doing that, but hopefully everything will begin to turn back to normal in our world sooner than later. We hope so. We certainly hope so. Friends, this concludes our announcements this morning and our opening song today, as we have a few of the Von Ryder family with us today. Dave and Luke helping Clay out. Opening song today is Build My Life. Thank you. Amen. Please pray with me. Lord our God, as we worship you on the Sabbath day, or maybe people are watching this at a different time, any time when we are with you, Lord, is a time of Sabbath, a holy time when we can be in your presence and be filled by your Spirit. So we pray, Lord, as people worship this morning from home, wherever they might be, they would feel your Spirit and know that no matter where they are, you are with them, that they are in your presence, and they can be filled by your Spirit and find rest in you. In your name we pray. Amen. Friends, it's time for the children's sermon. So if you have kids at home and they are kind of paying attention at times like this, you can put them in front of the computer, whatever you might be watching it on. I'm just going to talk for a few minutes, as I always do, about my theme for the day a little bit and on a kid's level. So kids, let me start by saying, I'm talking about rest today, but I believe in hard work. I believe in working hard in life. I don't think there's any substitute for having what adults will tell you is a strong work ethic, and that means basically believing in working hard. You can be born with lots of talent like Clay, but if you don't practice, if you don't work hard at improving your piano playing, you won't ever play the piano like Clay. He's got to practice and work hard, even though he was born with talent. So you might be somebody who was born smart, but you still got to do your homework and everything in school. You've got to work hard. You've got to work hard if you want to do well in school. Carol Hawkins is sitting here this morning in worship, and she had knee surgery recently, and so she had to do therapy, and she had to work hard at that. If she wanted her knee to be able to work right again, you've got to work hard. You can't do things without doing them to your very best. So I believe anything you do in life, you should give your best. You should work hard. You'll have a job one day. I think you should work hard at it. I think that's how you accomplish things in life, by working hard and doing your best. And I really believe that. But I also believe that God created rest. God created us to need sleep. Think about that. You can stay up for a long time. You can stay up all night long, maybe, and stay up for a day, a night, and maybe some of the next day. Eventually, though, you're going to fall asleep. And if God created a world, of course, where we need sleep, we need rest, and God made day, and God made night, and God made us to need sleep. And I don't think that's an accident. God could have created the world so that we didn't need sleep, but we were created to need rest. And I think of it kind of like this. I've got my phone here with me, and right now, because I just unplugged a little while ago, the battery is charged to 97%. And most of you, if you're not old enough to have a phone yet, you at least know what I'm talking about, that there's a battery inside of my phone. As my day goes along, I'll have a lot of text messages and calls, and I'll surf a few times for different things on my phone, because I do that. And by the end of the day, my battery will be worn down some. I've had this battery for a while, too, so it wears down pretty fast. And every night, it used to be that way when I first got it, I didn't have to charge it that often, but now, every night, I've got to charge my phone, so it'll be ready for the next day. And so, yeah, I've got to plug it in, as you know, so it gets power, so the battery can charge again. Rest is kind of like that. I believe in working hard. I don't think there's any substitute for working hard. But when you're done working, it's okay to rest. God created us to need rest. And also, I believe God created us to need to be in God's presence, in God's Spirit. Worship is one of the ways that God charges us again. Because when we worship, we're in the presence of God and God's Spirit, and we always pray that God's Spirit will fill us and renew us. And I believe it charges us again, because the world outside, with everything that goes on, all the bad things that can happen around us, and all the people who need our love and our attention and everything, it can drain us, it can wear us down. But God's Spirit fills us up again so that we can be filled with love again as we start a new week. And so we can be able to let that love flow out of us again. But then we kind of come in like a battery. We get in God's presence again, and we're charged again. And again, God gives us the strength that we need, and the God's Spirit that we need, the love that we need, the patience that we need to be able to face each week again. And sometimes even kids can be facing hard times. When you're facing a hard time, I just want to encourage you to try to be with God and pray to God, and pray that God will give you the strength that you need, or the God's Spirit inside you, whatever you need to make it through what you're going through. because I believe God does. Now, the commandment we're going to talk about today is remembering the Sabbath and keeping it holy. And what that means is having that time to rest and recharge and be in God's presence so we can have God's Spirit fill us again and kind of charge us like a battery in a phone or something so we have what we need to face the next day or the next week. Let's pray together. Dear God, thank you for all the blessings that you give to us. And thank you, Lord, that you continually give us your Spirit, that we can always plug into your Spirit like a phone into an electric source so that we can have the power that we need. Lord, may we always remember to take time to be holy, take time to be in your presence, take time to rest in you so we can have what we need to face the next day, to face this day, and to face any problem that we might have, and just to let your love flow out from us to those who need it. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks, everybody. We're going to begin with some joys as we do our joys and concerns today. And first, this is mostly from the people who have come over to our church family from First Church, but also those here from Hallen, longtime members as well. In our sanctuary this morning, the guys are going to put a picture up here for you. They have taken the eternal light from First Church, and it's been put up here in our sanctuary, and it's above the door. So as you're coming in the sanctuary or exiting the sanctuary, as you look up, you'll see that. And it's on a dedicated channel so that it's on all the time, just as it was when it was at First Church. So we've continued to take some of the history and great things from First Church and incorporate those here into our church here. And so we're thankful for all the people that have come, of course, and become part of our family, and also the things that we could preserve those traditions from First Church. Also, I kind of got thrown off last week when the power went out, and I was scrambling to try to remember what I was preaching on and put some notes together furiously, so I forgot my bad dad jokes last week that I wanted to try to do to make you laugh a little bit, but I've got those two from last week and a new one from this week, too. So here's the first of those. I just bought a thesaurus, and when I got home, all the pages were blank. I have no words to describe how angry I am. Here's the next one. Did you hear this? I picked this one out for the Super Bowl last week, Sunday, and then forgot it. Did you hear about the new football league that pits NFL teams against prison football teams? It has its pros and cons. And here's one from this week. Warning, don't accept a friend request from Hormel Foods. It might be spam. So there you go, just some few bad dad jokes. One of the gifts I was given this year for Christmas, a bad dad joke calendar. So I'll share a few with you so we can have a little bit of levity in this time when so much is going on in our country with the pandemic and everything else. So God gave us the gift of laughter as well and gave dads the gift of bad jokes too, I guess. So friends, a few other joys to share about members of our congregation. Carla Gibson, that's Sarah Mosher's daughter, her surgery went well, so we praise God for that. Doris Young is home, and I was able to FaceTime her yesterday because Nancy Moore is there with her now, and so Nancy's thankful to be with her, and Doris is doing better. We praise God for that. Tom Orwig spoke to Carol the other day at a finance meeting, and Tom is doing better. He's off oxygen during the day, but he still has oxygen at night, complications from COVID. So please keep Tom Orwig in your prayer still. And then I got a Valentine from Bob Gribling this week. So if my wife doesn't give me a Valentine, at least I got one from Bob Gribling. I got from a few other people, actually, in church. But Bob updated me to let me know he's still going to the gym several times a week, even though he's taking these treatments for non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. He doesn't have symptoms that are bad, so we praise God for that. And then I saw Dale Gephardt in my office a few days ago. He's going to be looking as skinny as his son, Doug, soon as he loses weight, maybe as much as Kristen is, as much as he's losing weight. He's looking skinny, but he's doing well, and he is coming towards the end of his treatments as well. So please continue to keep Dale in your prayers, but he's looking good and hopefully doing well. And then we have some other updates for people. I want to remember people who have lost loved ones a few weeks ago now. Susan Musser passed away, so please keep Don and the family in your prayers. Peggy Smith, that's Sally Allen's sister. Her husband died recently. Please keep them in your prayers. And Betty Allen's son passed away, and Betty's going to be in Tennessee with her daughter, so please remember them. And then a few other new updates. Karen Hanna, that's Lynn Ryder's mom, has health concerns, so please keep Karen in your prayers. Tom Sneed, that's Sarah Mosier's brother, fell and had surgery. Wyatt Gerard, it's Glenda McCracken's 13-year-old grandnephew. The surgery went well, but there's infection around the heart, so please keep Wyatt Gerard in your prayers. And everyone else will continue to mention as I pray this morning. We'll mention, lifting everyone else's name up in prayer as well. So friends, as we prepare our hearts for prayer, I invite you to listen to this song, Word of God Speak, a song that talks about sometimes we may not have the words that we need, but we can just be in God's presence, and God's presence speaks to us. It's Word of God Speak. So before I pray, friends, that song says exactly what I kind of want to say today. So Clay, Dave, and it would be Jake, I'm going to make a change if I can, please. And after the prayer today, instead of seek you first, let's sing Take Time to Be Holy there, Clay. And then Dave and Clay, if we can repeat that song at the end for the closing song today. We'll do Word of God Speak again at the end and figure out where you want to take the bridge from after the benediction. Guys, when I do the sermon, just take a minute and figure that out, please. I just listening to that song, it says what I want to say today. So thinking about that, would you please take a moment and pray with me today? Lord God, I pray that your word would speak to us. Your word through your Bible as we read it, your word through your Spirit as we come into your presence and open up our hearts and lives to you. Because certainly, Lord, this world needs to hear your voice right now, speaking loud and clear. And So we need to be open to that, Lord. We need to have Sabbath time, a time of rest, a holy time, a time to be in your presence, to be filled by your Spirit. And Lord, not only do we need it ourselves, but certainly the leaders of our country, the leaders of this world, and all those, Lord, who are doing so much in so many ways right now as we go everything with the virus and getting the vaccine distributed and everything that needs to be done now in this world, Lord, and so much going on. Speak to us, Lord. Let us have open eyes and open ears to hear the word of God speak. Let it fill our hearts and the hearts of everyone, Lord, so we can hear you speaking to us at a time when we desperately not to be yelling ourselves and not saying what we need to say or have the words that we think we believe, but hear you speak to us. Fill us, Lord, with your Spirit, so it can flow out from us into this world that needs it so much. Lord God, we pray for all the people that we've mentioned this morning. We pray for Karen Hanna and Carla Gibson, Tom Sneed and Wyatt Gerard, Louise Hartle and Doris Young, for Jim and Jen and Reagan as they mourn the passing of Ruby, and for Don Musser and his family, and Peggy Smith and Betty Allen as they mourn the loss of loved ones, for Bert Morales and Donna Lohman and Charles Mock and Tom Orwig and Kay Dunlap and Charlene Boomhauer, for Bob Gribling and Nancy Miggs and Nancy Hoy, for Dave Gibbs and Dale Gephardt, Joe Brothag and John Schuliger, for anyone else, Lord, who needs the touch of your healing hand or the strength and comfort of your Holy Spirit, anyone that we're mentioning out loud at home or in our hearts, Lord, let them feel your presence with them. Let them know that they are not alone, that the word of God speaks to them in their time of need and gives them hope and strength. Let them hear you speak to them, Lord, and know that you are with them. And wherever it is possible, Lord, let us be a source of hope and encouragement and reminder that you are with them, that they're not alone, that they have our love and support as well. And Lord, we just pray for this country right now, and we pray for this world right now with everything that's going on. 2020 was such a hard year, and 2021, there's so much going on already, Lord. But still, our hope is in you, for you are God. You're the God that created the universe. You're bigger than anything that we face, and we know the way that we get through anything we need to face is when we open ourselves up to you. And so, Lord, let us have open hearts, willing to come and have Sabbath time, be in your presence, have you fill us, so we can not only make it through our day and face what we need to face, but let that love hope flow out from us into the hearts and lives of others so that they can have the strength that they need to face their day as well. Lord God, we ask your blessings upon everyone who needs it, and that's all of us, this whole country and this whole world. We pray these things this morning in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the one who taught us to pray together saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So friends, as we prepare our hearts for this morning's message, I ask Clay if you'd make a change for us, and we're going to sing Take Time to Be Holy as we're thinking about the Sabbath and what it means. It means taking time to be holy and being in God's presence. So this familiar hymn reminds us that message, to take time to be holy.
Make friends with God's children.
Amen. Would you please pray with me and for me? O Lord, may the words of my mouth and meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Friends, if you've been worshiping from home, you know I'm doing a series on the Ten Commandments, and today we're going to read about the fourth commandment, which we've referenced many times now, to remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. Let's look at these exact verses from Exodus 20, there are 8 through 11. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. In it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your manservant or your maidservant, or your cattle or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord God made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it, made it holy, made it honored, set it apart. So let's begin with what the word Sabbath means. We were just reminded that God created the world in 6 days. On the seventh day, God rested, so people should also. The seventh day should be a Sabbath day of rest dedicated to the Lord our God. Sabbath comes from the Hebrew word that means rest. Here's a slide showing the word Sabbath, as well as the word sabbatical, which comes from the same Hebrew word. A Sabbath is a day of rest every 7 days. A sabbatical is a time of rest every 7 years. Traditionally, it's every 7 years, because it's the root of the word where that idea comes from. So you've heard of the word sabbatical before. I just put there so you understand it's the same root of the word that means rest. That's how we get words like sabbatical in our language. So what is a Sabbath? It's a holy day, a day of rest every 7 days. What is a sabbatical, that period of rest every 7 years? This is a commandment God gives to the people to have a Sabbath, a time of rest, and keep it holy, dedicated to God. People worshipped on the Sabbath back then, and we still do. The day is to be dedicated to God. When God gave the commandment at first to the people, it was just a simple commandment, just the verses that we just read. But then human beings got hold of it, and eventually there were many, many rules about what could and could not be done on the Sabbath, what was work you could do, and what was work you couldn't do. There were 39 different categories of work and hundreds of rules about them. These rules didn't come directly from God, like the Ten Commandments being given to Moses on a mountain. They're created by religious leaders to help people understand what was work and what wasn't work, what it meant to have a day of rest. So the simple commandment eventually became a lot of rules and regulations for people to follow. I always say inside me, I have a Republican half and a Democrat half. And here's one area where the Republican half of me comes out. I'm in favor of deregulation. The people in Bible times became obsessed with following all the rules and regulations that people created about how to follow the commandment about the Sabbath and missed the spirit of the original commandment from God. I mean, who does like rules and regulations? Who gets excited when the boss says, I'd like to sit down with you and show you new rules and regulations? You should be receiving your information from your work for your tax purposes now, if you're someone still employed, who thinks to themselves, who thinks to themselves when they sit down to do their taxes, gosh, I hope they made a lot of new tax laws this year. I hope those rules were expanded, so I've got to read about them and learn how they affect me this year. Nobody, well, I don't think, many people anyways, think that. The number of rules and regulations the church preschool alone has to follow from the government is absurd. It's why the Republican side of me always comes out when it comes to the subject of deregulation. Fewer rules mean fewer restrictions and more freedom. The people who loved all the rules about the Sabbath when Jesus was here on earth were the Pharisees. That's because they were the ones in charge of interpreting and enforcing all the rules and regulations. They had power. Unfortunately, they became so obsessed with all the rules and regulations, they lost sight of the spirit of the original commandment from God to remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. Here are a few examples where Jesus points that out to them. First is from Mark chapter 2, verses 23 through 28. One Sabbath, he was going through the grain fields, and as they made their way, his disciples began to pluck heads of grain. And the Pharisees said to him, this is Jesus, look, why are they doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath? Because they're working. They're in the field. They're gleaning in the field. And he said to them, have you never read what David did when he was in need and was hungry? He and those who were with him, how he entered the house of God when Abiathar was high priest, then ate the bread of the presence, which is not lawful for any but the priest to eat, and also gave it to those who were with him. And he said to them, the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath. The Sabbath was made for man. The Sabbath was made for us. A time of rest was made for us. Here's another example. And they went on from there and entered their synagogue. And behold, there was a man with a withered hand. And they asked him, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath? So they might accuse him, because he'd be doing work if he were healing someone on the Sabbath. He said to them, what man of you, if he has one sheep and it falls into a pit on the Sabbath, will not lay hold of it and lift it out? How much more value is a man than a sheep? So it is lawful to do good on the Sabbath. Then he said to the man, stretch out your hand. And the man stretched it out, and it was restored whole like the other. But the Pharisees went out and took counsel against him, how to destroy him. You know, Jesus was trying to teach them, the Sabbath is meant to be a day of rest, a holy time. Does that mean I don't do good things on the Sabbath because you don't have a rule, you consider it work, or people who are hungry can't gather food for themselves? You're missing the spirit of the commandment, what it means to be in God's presence and take holy time. So then, what is this for us today? What is still the spirit of the commandment for us today? If we strip away all the rules and regulations that the Pharisees had about what it means, what does it mean to us today? The Sabbath is about time. It's a commandment about time. Time is arguably the greatest gift God has given each one of us. Imagine you won an incredible prize in a contest at your bank. Each morning, your bank puts $86,400 in a private account just for you. Every day, $86,400. But the prize comes with a few rules, and they're going to put these up here for you. You must spend all $86,400 every day. Anything you don't spend will not be there tomorrow. Every penny must be spent each day. 2, you can't transfer the money into another account. 3, you can't just give the money to someone else. And finally, 4, the bank will choose a day to stop awarding the prize and close the account at any time, but you never know when this will happen. But until it does, you will receive $86,400 every day. What would you do? You would buy anything and everything you wanted. You would be sure to spend it all every day and be so thankful for what you could do with it. You would spend money buying things for people you love and care about. You would make the most of that prize every day until the day finally came when the bank closed that account. Well, friends, this gift is real. It's called time. You see, every day has 86,400 seconds in it. Today, you receive the prize of having 86,400 seconds to spend any way you want to. Tomorrow, you will receive the same prize. Yesterday's seconds are gone. They can't be saved for today or tomorrow. And one day, for all of us, the gift we call time will end. But until that day comes, and it will someday for each one of us, every day is a gift from God. It's one of God's greatest gifts to us. It doesn't feel that way sometimes, does it? The phrase TGIF that was popular some time ago, thank God it's Friday, is a phrase everyone understands. If you're still working, it means you're glad when that work week is over. You're ready for a few days to relax and enjoy life because life can be so hectic. I'm sure many of you feel like I do sometimes. Sometimes I feel like I'm just trying to make it through each day. There are never enough hours in the day to do everything we need to do. Sometimes it seems you can't wait to collapse into bed because we're so tired. We want the day to be over. On days like that, sometimes I have to remind myself that every day is a gift. In fact, every day is a special occasion. Here's an article that appeared several years ago in the Los Angeles Times. My brother-in-law and I were going through my sister's clothes. He opened the bottom drawer of my sister's bureau and lifted out a tissue-wrapped package. It was a slip. It was exquisite, silk trimmed with a cobweb of lace. He said, Jan bought this when we went to New York several years ago. She never wore it. She was saving it for a special occasion. Well, I guess this is the occasion. He took the slip and placed it on the bed with the other clothes we had picked out to send to the mortician. His hand lingered on the soft material for a second. Then he said, don't ever save anything for a special occasion. Every day you're alive is a special occasion. I remembered his words long after my sister's funeral and her unexpected death. I still remember them today. They changed my life. Now I'm reading more and dusting less. I'm sitting on the deck and admiring the view without worrying about the weeds I see. I'm spending more time with my family and friends and less time at work. I'm not saving anything for special occasions. We use our good china to celebrate occasions like someone losing a single pound, when the sink gets unstopped, when we see the first bloom of spring. I'm eating my favorite foods and my favorite desserts. I'm not waiting to take that vacation next year. I'm forgiving people now while I have the chance. I'm treating every day like the special occasion it is. And every morning when I open my eyes, I tell myself, today is another gift from God. It's a great article, someone wrote. It's important to remind ourselves every day is a gift. And so is every one of the 86,400 seconds in each day. This woman figured it out and is living that way. Sometimes I feel like the older I get, the faster time seems to go by. I know, of course, that isn't true. It just feels like time goes by faster the older I get. And I know I'm not alone in feeling that way because sometimes people much older than I am say to me when I say something like that, you think time goes fast now, wait till you're my age, then you'll really see how fast time goes by. Which seems to mean everyone understands somehow. The older we get, the faster time seems to go to most people. It doesn't seem that long ago my kids were little. Now two are in college and Christian's about to graduate in a few months and even Elizabeth will start high school this fall. It hardly seems possible. There's something about life that as we age, we gain perspective on how quickly time does go by and how every day is a gift. This brings me to one final scripture verse you may not know, but one which surely speaks to this subject. It's Psalm 90, verse 12. So teach us to number our days, that we may gain, we may get a heart of wisdom. Teach us to number our days. Help us to appreciate our time here is limited, it's finite, it's going to end one day, and it goes fast. When we understand that, when we really understand that, we gain a heart of wisdom, because it should give us perspective on how we should spend our time. The fourth commandment is to remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. It's a commandment about time. It means remember to set aside some time just to rest, to be with the ones you love, to take time for yourself, and to set aside time for God. A time of worship is a time of rest. It's a time of resting from the worries of our world and allowing ourselves to be filled with God's Spirit anew, to hear the Word of God speak to us like that song that Dave has sung. So we have God's Spirit inside of us so we can face the week again. That's the idea, the meaning of the fourth commandment, to have Sabbath time. Now, our Jewish brothers and sisters still have Saturday as the Sabbath, as they follow the Old Covenant. A long time ago, most Christians set aside Sunday as the Sabbath to worship, because that's the day that Jesus was resurrected, and we follow the New Covenant. But no matter if you're watching this worship service on a Wednesday night, or if you have your time of rest for yourself or family time any time during the week, to me, it's the spirit of the commandment that matters. That is, we need to have Sabbath time. We need to have time to be in God's presence. We need to have holy time to be with God, a time to rest, just like we need to have time to dedicate to the people that we love. I would argue the single greatest gift you can give someone is your time. If we number our days, as the scripture says, if we realize we only have so many days, then we understand we only have so much time. When you give someone your time, you show them how important they are to you. That's why we're commanded to regularly give time to God, because God should be that important to us. You heard me say last week, we can make anything into a god when we give it our time and devotion, but nothing should come before the one true God. When we take Sabbath time to worship God and be filled by God's Spirit, we're making sure we're having nothing else before God. You see, the first four commandments are all related. Having nothing before God, not using God's name in vain, taking Sabbath time to be filled with God's Spirit, they're all about helping us have the relationship we need to have with God. It's a relationship, and relationships take time. When I was growing up, blue laws were largely still in effect. Blue laws were laws that prevented many businesses from being open on Sunday, especially Sunday morning, so that people could have a day of rest and a time to worship. You might not know the Supreme Court ruled several times that blue laws were constitutional. They didn't violate a separation of church and state. The blue laws were good for, quote, societal stability, unquote, because they protected workers and families by providing a time of rest and promoted the free exercise of religion. As you know, although there are still some blue laws still in effect in some states, especially some restricting the sale of alcohol on Sundays, for the most part, blue laws don't exist anymore. And when I was growing up, there was no such thing as kids playing organized sports on Sunday mornings. It was unheard of. And in telling you this, I'm showing my age a little bit. I'm sounding like my grandfather when I was a child, who would tell me how the world was different when he was young. I'm sounding like my grandfather by talking about how when I was young, the world was different. Our country took the fourth commandment very seriously to have a Sabbath time back then, not like we do today. The world has changed. Well, the world has changed. It keeps changing all the time. It changed during my grandfather's lifetime. It changed during my lifetime so far. It will continue to change. But the commandment from God has not. We still need to dedicate time to God, to rest. We need to dedicate time to the ones we love. Without blue laws and with technology, meaning we carry those phones around and devices with us everywhere, that we're never really disconnected, it means the pace of life only gets faster and faster for each generation. And so I'm convinced it becomes even more important to have Sabbath time, to disconnect from the world, to connect with God and the people we love. The busier life becomes, the more we need to set aside that Sabbath time. Today is Valentine's Day. And yes, you may think it's just a day created by businesses to sell cards and flowers and candy. It can certainly be commercial like anything else. But it's meant to be a day each year that we set aside to tell the people we love most that we love them. That's not just your husband or wife. It's the people you love, whoever they are. It's a reminder to set aside time and give a gift or card or something that says, "You matter to me." But really, it's a holiday reminding us to give time to the people we love. And so, that's what the fourth commandment is too. It's a reminder to give your time, because time is arguably the greatest gift you have to give. And because time has been given to us by God, we should gratefully give some of that time back to God. Whether it's worshiping, praying, reading our Bible, serving at church somehow, or helping someone in need. Time is the greatest gift you can give back to God or to anyone you love. The Pharisees back in the days of Jesus had many rules to follow about the Sabbath. And it became about following rules. Jesus tried to deregulate that commandment for them to understand the spirit of the law. Here's what the commandment really means, the spirit of the law. Realize how precious time is, and set aside some time to be holy and give it to God, to give it to those you love, to rest and have the strength to face the week again. For those of you who are younger, the busier this world gets and the faster life moves, the more important it is to have Sabbath time, even though it may seem hard to find that time to set aside. For those of you who are older and whose kids are grown perhaps and you might have more time to give, each day is still a gift. You are still here and God still has you here and is still giving you the gift of time. Your time still matters. Find ways to give that time to God and the people you love. Even if you don't go out anymore, you can still be sending cards or things like that. You see, no matter how young we are or old we are, no matter what stage of life we might be in, time is one of the most precious gifts you've been given. Today has 86,400 seconds in it, and they won't come back again. They can only be used today. Make them count. To me, that's what today's commandment really means. Remember the Sabbath. Keep it holy. It means make each moment count. I believe in working hard. I believe in having a strong work ethic. A work ethic is how we change the world somehow when we're working hard to try to make it a better place, when we're working hard at our jobs or whatever we need to do. But we need to have Sabbath time to be with God, to be with the ones that we love. We need to make those moments count. Amen. Friends, as you know, I just asked Dave and Clay if they would sing that song again for us, because sometimes we don't have to have the words to say. We don't have to be trying to speak to God, and we wonder if we pray sometimes if we don't have the right words, or we don't know what to pray for in this world with everything that's going on and all the problems that it faces, and sometimes we don't know the right words to say to somebody else, but we can be in God's presence. We can hear God's word speak to us and feel God's spirit in us, filling us, recharging us, so that it can flow out from us somehow into this world. So listen to this song once more, Word of God Speak. It's okay.
last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say.
Friends, I've been a pastor for 26 years, and I've performed hundreds and hundreds of funerals. Many of you have heard me give eulogies at funerals. I try to write them very carefully because I know every eulogy I write is a story about how someone lived out, how they spent one of the greatest gifts they had, their time. One day I'll be telling that story about you, or someone will be telling that story about you or about me one day. So we need to make sure that we are setting aside time to be holy, to worship God and be filled with God's Spirit. We need to make sure we're setting aside time for the ones that we love. We need to make sure that we use our time wisely, every moment we've been given. But I believe when we're filled with God's Spirit, you hear me say this all the time, I know, but it's because it kind of defines who I am when I believe. When we're filled with God's Spirit, that's what can flow out from us into this world. If you think of your heart like a battery that needs to be charged, when we come into God's presence and have Sabbath time, God can charge us again, fill us again. Not only so we can face the things we need to face, but so it can flow out from us to everyone who needs God's love. One day, when they tell the story about how you lived your life and how you spent your time, may the thing that pastor says on that day be, this person spent their time letting the love of God flow out from them into this world because this person was regularly in the presence of God and everyone could see it by the way this person lived and loved, by the way they spent their time. So take time to be holy, take time for Sabbath time for God, for those you love. It's one of the greatest gifts you've been given. Give some of it back to God and others, and use every moment in a way that makes each moment count. So not about the rules and regulations they had in the Bible times. It's about how to live it out. It's about understanding the spirit of that, what it means. So take it and live your lives that way. And as you do, may the blessings of God the Father Almighty, Jesus Christ, His Son, our Lord and Savior, and the peace and unity of the Holy Spirit be with you now and may it do forevermore. Amen.